inside a dead man's mouth. Why? No scream, no sigh of relief rises from the darkness inside. It's humid there, sickly sweet air unlike anything living. You feel like you're about to throw up again, straight in that mouth of his. Ugh. Pain threshold says, no you don't. You can keep it in. You can keep anything in. No. We'll write it down. He wipes his brow. Hepatobiliary. N.A. Why? Don't we have anything? He looks at the corpse's stomach with a mixture of tiredness and disgust. Are you a hepatobiliary expert? I don't think so. I can barely even say that. Neither am I. And that's it? That's it. Right, N.A. Same for toxicology and serology. N.A. Both? Useless unless you have untapped reservoirs of knowledge there. Encyclopedia says reservoirs? No, but they take obscure trivia and odd tidbits. Would obscure tidbits and odd trivia fit the fields? No. The completionist in me wonders if there's something we could still do. Like a toxicology screening? He looks at the monster. At this stage, I doubt processing will find anything, even if he was brimming with cocaine. But still, he should add a request. Write N.A. and add toxicology requested. That might be a good thing. Cardiovascular. The body exhibits heavy lividity. Blood has gathered in the hands, feet, and neck. Hypostasis is visually consistent with a hanging. Gastrointestinal. He breathes a sigh of approaching relief. This is the last field on the list. He looks around. To the ground, the pool of feces there. Logic says, this will do. Then he touches the corpse's bloated lower abdomen briefly and says, digested semi-solid food in the stomach. Voila. Write it down, keep the voila. Why not? What's next on the list? 3. Description of injuries. Summary. Let's see. He tilts his head. We have bite marks, contusions on head and chest, and a ligature mark encircling the neck. You'll need 3 fields. You have a 4th one, too. What about the injuries we have afflicted? Hold on, guys. Clear my throat. Oh? He looks incredulous. So we inflicted them? Okay, I have inflicted. Okay, there's a spin-stabilized munition from a Kajil A990 muzzle loader lodged in his lung. That's from when we tried to shoot the body down and failed. There's a pause. I don't think we should mention that. Better not to muddy the waters. I agree. The waters are muddy enough. See? These pigs are corrupt! The boy nods approvingly. He likes that we might be corrupt. Well, you screw them if you love them so much. Kim says, now, injuries. 1. Bite marks. He nods. Head, chest, and scalp bite mark injuries. Predation by birds has caused damage to the body. Odontologist does not need to be consulted. And your opinion, officer? Beneath the description, there are 2 boxes waiting to be ticked. B. Non-fatal post-mortem. Agreed. Next injury? 2. Contusions. So, the scalp bleeds from a post-mortem head injury, a stone. The injury does not have the rim of an early inflammatory response. A perpetrator on the scene has confessed to causing it post-mortem. At maximum velocity, Kuno yells. He has confessed to causing it at maximum velocity. Coagulated blood sticks to his scalp and chest, where the countless stones have hit the dead man. Beneath the description of injury, 2 boxes. B. Non-fatal postmortem. Right. Next. 3. Ligature mark. Wait, what's the 4th injury field for? Nothing, just in case. Alright. Ligature mark. 3. A dark red abraded ligature mark encircling the neck with a gape on the nape measuring, let's say, 7 centimeters. The hyoid bone is fractured, the cervical column intact. I see hemorrhaging on the skin above and below the ligature mark. Depth of the mark, 1 centimeter. No signs of clawing on the neck. Below the note, two customary boxes wait to be ticked. The man's head jerks to the side, awaiting your judgment. The ring around his neck is visible. A. Opinion. Fatal injury. That's it. He cracks an uneasy smile. We have established cause of death. It's not much. It leaves much to be questioned, but it's a start. We level up again. Two more skill points. He produces a small plastic roll from his jacket, a body bag. Let's wrap this up. I pronounce this field autopsy over. First, how did it go? Well, we established probable cause of death. Some would say that's the goal of an autopsy. We also requested a toxicological screening. That was thorough. The results should arrive in a couple of weeks, if we're lucky. I would not hold my breath. What else? We were thorough with the list of injuries, too. We described them all in detail. What is there to say? Given the circumstances, it was a professional field autopsy. What now? I need a copy of that autopsy form. Then I will drive him to Farberg. Rip out a copy of the autopsy pages. For processing. He looks at the dead man one more time, then at the slip of red paper in his hand, then at the corpse again. We can't leave, yeah. We need to... He needs to go to sleep, so he can take the boots. Empathy says, he's thinking, did I miss something? Visual calculus says, I'm sure he didn't get everything. There's always something. Oh my god, really? Perception. Search the body one more time thoroughly. Very low. Minus one for stop wasting time. You're smart. And number minus one for established probable cause. Failing, I'm sure. Success. Really? That's amazing. I wasn't watching the dice. I guess we got two sixes? Your arm reaches out and eyes close as if by their own volition. It's dark all around. You feel cold, slippery flesh. First with your fingertips, then under the palm of your hand. What is this? His face, his cheeks, his nose, his fat swollen lips, like a spider. Your hand crawls over his features. Everything is silent. Squeeze his nose? You pick it between your fingers. The mass is even larger than your nose. Very porous somehow, like it's about to pop. Keep crawling, lest you break it. Crawl up his nostrils? What are we doing? They are swollen shut. You need to really push to get in. Ew, I'm pushing my fingers into a dead man's nose. Fine. Only the little one fits. You mean my pinky? The flesh changes shape as you bore in, searching for something in the cartilage. The hell's he doing? You hear a voice squeak. It sounds very far away. The thing you're looking for, it's not here either. Crawl out, spider. Is this what we were gonna, like, look deeper in his mouth? But we're gonna put our fingers in his mouth? The oral cavity is cold and moist. A ball-like tongue attaches itself to the base of the mouth, rolling around like a scallop. Oh my god. Inland Empire says you're on the right track. Play with it? This feels right? Are you sure? The tongue moves freely in the cavity. The mucus of the mouth is slippery. Delicate to touch. Ugh. From the soft meat, teeth are budding. Hard pearls of bone in the gums and in the back of the mouth. God. I haven't read something more disgusting since, like, I think a Clive Barker short story, Books of Blood. Good God. Perception says, can you feel it? You're so close. Rip his jaws open now, look in. Rip his jaws, okay, open your eyes and look. A vision of black and dark red death, pried open by your naked hands and studded with teeth. Looks like he's laughing, death fumes rising from the throat. And there, in the back of his mouth, above the bell of the uvula, right in the soft palate, you see a hole, barely visible to the human eye. It is swollen shut, almost vanished, no larger than 0.4 centimeter in radius. The eyes appear darkened. Someone stabbed him through the mouth? Not shot him, because we would see it exploding out the back of the head. An abrasion collar, visual calculus says. This is what we're after. What's an abrasion collar? Encyclopedia! Say abrasion collar. Abrasion collar. Kim looks in. There's a pen in his hand. His notebook is open at the copy paper. Kuna was silent. Touch it with your finger gently. A black trickle of liquid runs into his throat from the wound. Am I poking my fingers in the hole in the top of his fucking mouth? Put your finger in. Your index finger fits right in there. A tight tunnel of flesh opens up. Tissue damage, wide enough for two fingers. As you push both in, you reach through his mouth right into his brain stem. How are we doing this? How are we actually doing this? Because before, he could not even get close to this body without puking. And now he's got his fingers in his mouth through a frickin' hole in his, the top of his mouth. And touching his frickin' brain stem? The hell is happening, Kuno S says. Yep, for once I agree with you, Kuno S. Oh crap, see? I almost said it. Brainstem? Yes, that's what this part is called. Physical instrument says, you've seen the drawings, you've studied them. Feel around first? Oh my god. The basal ganglia feels clumpy. What entered here has torn apart his reptilian complex. Oh, my ancient reptilian brain is gonna be like... Like, what the hell, man? Conceptualization says, this man will never sleep again. Never wake. Push deeper? Your fingers slide into the remains of his limbic system. There is no resistance. It's gelatinous. The slug-like structures are damaged, too. The tearing extends deep into both hemispheres. There's a cavity cut right between the hemispheres. The lieutenant answers with the sound of his pen on paper. Cavity! See? Kuno's voice is hushed. Oh, never mind. I had him yelling it. Empathy says, quivering with awe, push deeper. Your fingers are all the way in now, reaching toward the inside of his skull. The inside of his skull? How long are his freaking fingers? That's like his whole hand in there. The cavity goes further, but the entry wound isn't wide enough for the rest of your hand to follow. That's, like... I guess you could reach that. I'm, like, putting my fingers, like, outside... Well, not in my mouth right now, obviously. You can hear me talking. But I guess you could reach the inside of the skull. Not the top, but the, like, the side, kind of. The angled, like, kind of diagonal side. All the muscles in your body harden. Time to enter him. Really, physical instrument? You gotta put it like that. Wriggle in? Your fingers reach toward his skull. His cerebral cortex feels like jelly. Cold jelly. Strange fluid streams down your wrist as you push deeper. Until you feel it on the tip of your finger. Oh my god. Perception says, sharp, serrated material. The edges cut right into your skin. Right, someone stabbed him right in the frickin' brain. Pain threshold says, the pain is barely noticeable under the adrenaline rush. Oh, meaning I... Oh, it cut into my skin. I feel a solid object right under the skull. Maybe we can make this even better. Can you get to it? He searches his pockets for something. Inspect the skull first. There's a tiny crack, a protrusion in the cranium, right in the back of his head. Your finger must be pointing straight at it from the inside. The object that is in there stopped just short of the skull in the encephalus, knocking this tiny fracture into the cranium, visual calculus says. We have the makings of a very small exit wound here. The lieutenant leans closer. Kunoa says, forget about the exit wound, Bino. The pig is worrying him like a bleep puppet. All right. Alright, I made it very high. Plus one for precise spot of exit wound. If I fail this... There you go. You pick the object between your index and middle finger. Feels sharp, like metal. You press your teeth together. Your jaw is clenched. All you need to do is just... whisper, "I got it." Kuno says, "My pig's got it!" I whispered that. So you couldn't hear. And you heard anyway. Authority says he's watching his old man get the big prize at the claw game. Kuno S says, "What? What is it?" Slowly pull your fingers out. The inside of the head feels cold and smooth like a glove as you pull out. Really? As you pull out? Okay. You're making this too much like intercourse with the guy's freaking skull and brainstem. Sweat dripping down your brow, careful not to lose the prize between your fingers. With a plop, your hand emerges from the mouth, covered in blood up to the wrist. Blah. Between your fingers, a small flower, a blossom made of lead. Kunoa says, "Beautiful." "A bullet," Kim says. The lieutenant puts a small bag marked evidence under it. Really? A bullet. But didn't even exit from his skull. From like a very... yeah, I don't know. Maybe from like a 22 or something like that, which wouldn't... like, perforate and exit through the skull? The bone stopped it? I don't know, dropping in. The bullet falls in the bag, leaving a smattering of blood on the plastic. He raises the bag under his eyes and says, "Unknown caliber, rifled, some kind of brittle alloy, fractured on impact." Oh, a brittle alloy. Can I have it? Item gained, evidence, fractured bullet. Of course, you've earned it. The lieutenant drops the bag in your bloody hand. It feels light. He turns to his notebook. We need to add an item to the injury list. Injury number 4, ulva entry wound with an abrasion collar. Soft palate, back of mouth. High velocity, temporary cavity in brain tissue. Small exit wound on the occipital. He underlines the injury forcefully. How's that sound? Sounds about right. Opinion, fatal injury. Goddamn right. Click, click, goes the pen. And one last thing. We should amend injury number 3, ligament mark. New opinion, non-fatal post-mortem treatment. Logic says he's proposing the bullet was the real cause of death and the hanging an attempt to conceal this fact. Treatment? Treatment, officer, is an attempt to manipulate the body after death to hide the real cause with a false cause. In this case, he points to the mark encircling the corpse's neck. This injury here. The ligament mark. The fractured hyoid bone. It was all treatment. Yes, and the belt around his neck, the hanging, even dragging him to the yard. All of it was done after this man was already dead. Agreed. He nods. I have had my doubts since you showed me the tracks. Why did they carry him over? Why not march him, I thought. There was no satisfying explanation. Secret task complete. Find the bullet find the bullet before you get fooled. Okay. There have been other signs too. Small details. Everything is too neatly designed for us to assign probable cause here. As we did, foolhardily. Well, no more. We almost fell for it, he thinks. Almost. Logic says, there is of course the very real possibility he was both shot and hanged. Maybe they just shot him while they hanged him? To put him out of his misery? Kim thinks. It's possible, but it does not explain all the other dubious things here. Lack of struggle, primarily. I may be intellectually sloppy, but I prefer one theory at a time, and this just smacks of treatment to me. Why would anyone do this? To hide something. The real killer? The real motivation? What really happened here? Who would do this? That's for us to find out, but this will make finding them just a little easier. Maybe the bullet holds more answers? Yes, we should take a closer look at it. I am certain it has more to tell us. Hand-eye coordination says the little thing could reveal much about the weapon that shot it. I think I need to wash myself. Oh, he nods. You really, really do. I'm glad to hear you say that. Your room in the whirling rag should come with a bathroom. Be sure to make use of it in the evening. Okay, it's not even noon. Do I have to wait for the evening? What happens next? We bag the corpse and carry him to the holding pen of my kinema. I can transport him to processing myself, but I will be gone for the rest of the day. You'll be gone? What should I do in the meanwhile? Work on the case, tend to personal matters, try not to do anything too dangerous. An officer needs backup in a neighborhood like this. I know what to do. Get the boots. I'll leave that choice to you. And one more thing. He looks you in the eye. Great work, detective. Authority says the word lingers in the air of the basement. Far away, ice cream makers are buzzing and the sea wind blows outside. It's authority. That's like heaven. Detective. After you bag the corpse, Kim... Okay, this is the tutorial agent. After you bag the corpse, Kim will leave the party until tomorrow morning. You can do side tasks and even the main case, but it might be more difficult. Plan his exit accordingly. Plan his exit accordingly. Okay, this we're going to do while he's gone. The day won't pass here, right? We'll have time. Let's bag him. Take him away. The lieutenant takes the body away. You work alone for the rest of the day. Send victim's body to processing. Another point. We're getting to three more now. All right. Kim takes out a shiny black body bag and starts pulling the plastic over the dead man's face. What? There go those beautiful enamel boots. You will never own the full set now. May they rest in processing. Oh well, in another lifetime. What? I thought we could get into the kinema and get the boots. While Kim's gone. Oh, Kim's gonna take the kinema. Ah, to processing. Duh, I guess I was supposed to just leave, choose the last one, and not say leave. I will need a little help carrying him. You take the hands, I'll take the legs. Bag the corpse and drag it to the motor carriage. Damn it. Oh well. They're just boots. Yep, he left. Okay, I had to mute the music again. Alright, we got stuff. Unfortunately not boots, but we got other stuff. Evidence. Fractured bullet. This was pretty much a miracle that I found this thing. What was it, like 3% or something? The bullet mushroomed out on impact. It now looks more like a fanciful jacket button than something that could pierce skin, flesh, and bone. The bullet is safely sealed away in a plastic bag bearing the RCM stamp. Kim has filled out the label on the bag with the item number, case number, and date and location the bullet was found. Inland Empire says, beside his orderly handwriting, actually, the bullet looks especially sad, like a tiny shriveled head of cauliflower. What do I do with you, Bullet? The squished little thing has no idea. Visual Calculus says, I know! You should find the gun that shot this bullet. Find the gun that shot it! That sounds like something... Okay, I've got to gain a task. That sounds like something a police detective would do. First, you should learn all you can about this little guy. Visual Calculus says, then find the gun that shot it and the person who that gun belongs to. He used it to kill your victim. Neato. Feel the bullet through the bag. The squash bullet has some sharp edges where the jacket is split open. It feels cold, even through the bag. Encyclopedia says, you wouldn't ordinarily have cause to handle jacketed bullets. The citizen's militia uses cast bullets only, little pebbles of metal loaded from the muzzle, usually in a cartridge. Inspect the bullet closer. The jacket of the bullet is made of yellowish metal. It has blossomed out to reveal a dark gray core. The base of the bullet is close to 5 millimeters in diameter. Look at the jacket. You can just about make out a few striations near the base of the bullet. Little hairlines, linear, and feels standard. And the core? It's quite destroyed. Some of the fragments are still lodged in the wound. Interfacing says, what's interesting about this bullet thus far? It's a jacketed bullet close to 5 millimeters in diameter. A jacketed bullet, which would have been shot from a military-grade breech-loading rifle, not from a muzzle loader like those typically found on the streets of Martinez. Very interesting. You have an unusual military-grade bullet in your hand. Now all you need to do is to find the gun that could fire it. Very low. Try to determine what type of weapon shot this. Encyclopedia says this came from a breech loader. Of course, we know it fails. We could put a point to hand-eye coordination to try again. You can't remember what happened last week. What makes you think you're going to remember arcane firearm models? The bullet has nothing more to say. Put it away. Alright. And now we got... Find the murder weapon. You need to find the firearm that killed the hanged man. Something tells you it will take some time. You could start by identifying the bullet so you'd know the weapon that shot it. After that, keep your eyes open and be patient. Performed an advanced analysis using hand-eye coordination. Okay. Wash off the death smell. You reek of death. Wash it off. There's a bathtub in the room of the Whirling and Rags. A good place to visit once you can have some privacy. Well, we can have privacy now. Our field autopsy is complete. We did a lot of tasks. Holy crap. I can't run the number because he took the kinema. I can, however, level up 3 times. Alright, so... Needless to say, I'm going to put 1 into hand-eye coordination. I use 1 out of 2. Okay, wait. How do I... Accept changes in clothes. Thought... Wait a second. Oh, this. Unlock. Okay, I unlocked 1. What should I take? Rigorous self-critique. Criticize yourself. It's a good thing to know. Good thing to do. There's so much to choose from, though. Indirect modes of taxation. So this has to do with our memories, I guess? White mourning. I like the ones that have to do with his past. Apparently 3 of them so far. You're another capo type. The art cop. This is from Measurehead. I'm not messing with that. I don't want to betray Kim. Which is why I decided to knock out Measurehead instead. This has to do with you can drink and smoke. You can't do drugs on fair weather. Wasteland of Reality. Was this just... trying to quit drinking, which is a good thing in general. Well, these we don't have yet. Okay, good, because I was afraid I had to choose from all this. White Morning. Let's do, yeah, rigorous self-critique. You're one sorry piece of crap. A cop penitent, a flagellant cop monk. This is not the right line of work for you. You should be groveling at the feet of a feudal lord, providing lurid evidence against yourself at a Mazovian show trial, or ripping the flesh from your back with a cat of nine tails. Whatever made you this way, you can be damn sure it was your own fault. Do it. Really criticize yourself. Who knows, you might uncover something of importance from your guilt-ridden past. This doesn't sound healthy, but let's go for it. Alright, it takes 6 hours. On the map, okay. Oh, we can try this again right now, I guess. Oh, we have another we have one more skill point. You know what? Let me just save it for now. Still low. Plus one. Encyclopedia said this came from a breech loader. I wonder if we can get a better idea and plus it with some information what we might find some from someone else. Now this gun doesn't. This guy doesn't sell guns, but he might know something.
Hello again. How can I help you?
Yeah, nothing. Let's sell this postcard. And that postcard. And this postcard. Boogie Street postcard. Alright. I just want to see something about selling my clothes. Can I sell the clothes that I'm not wearing?
Hello again. How can I help you?
Or would it have to be the clothes I'm currently wearing, which I don't want to get rid of? Oh. That's grayed out. Let me just look at this. I'd like to sell my clothes. I'm not purchasing any more clothing at the moment. He looks you up and down quickly. Japanese have any guns like the ones carried by officers of the citizens' militia? Someone else came here earlier today asking the same question. I promptly sold her the gun you pawned a couple days back. Where can I find this buyer? He didn't know before. Alright. Who might know? Yeah, I can do all the stuff behind Katsuragi's back now. I have the whole damn day. Let me ask anyone I can about this.
Everything's still cool here, officer.
I don't mind then. Well, we could talk to the Hardie Boys. Since we're not talking to Titus Hardie, so let's go do that. Who's that? Wait a second. Who's that? Oh, the smoker from the balcony. Hey, Gendarme? Another rendezvous. There he is again. The smoker on the balcony, right here in the whirling in rags. Hello. Hello, hello. So what brings you here? I met your Sunday friend. You did? A small smile adorns his face. And how'd you like him? You were right. He was magical. Magically bureaucratic. I told you, he can be very useful. I guess that's the charm of powerful people. Who is he? A visitor from the First World. He's not like you and me, Gendarme. He smiles, and his smile seems melancholic. He can always return. Return where? To his opportunities in Occident, Sir Leclef. Still, he breathes in and keeps his lungs filled for a moment before letting it out. His coming and going brings some life to the village. Or is it just money? I don't know. He stares at the bar. Why was he staying at your place in the middle of the night? He has keys, and he likes the view. He waves gently with his cigarette-holding hand. To the sea, What are you, you two? Friends, I told you. Sunday friends. Friends who like to get together from time to time. What does it mean, a Sunday friend? That he won't be here when times get tough, I guess. Is that even a friend? It is. On Sundays. He smiles. I don't want to talk about other people. I want to talk about you. What about me, Gendarme? Tell me again about that muscular type who came to investigate the crime. Oh, yes, let's see. He knocked on my door a few days after the lynching. I think he was going through the entire building, asking questions. Besides muscular, did he have any other identifying traits? Oh, let me think. He turns his eyes upward in recollection. He had an accent. He sounded like one of those mercenaries. He sounded vaguely Aranyese. He closes his eyes. No, not vaguely. Scratch that. He sounded definitely Aranyese. Isn't that Measurehead? Is a Measurehead Aranyese? What did he look like? Muscular? Handsome? He smiles nonchalantly. Strong, like one of those military types. Was he alone? Yes, but he was speaking to someone on his earpiece. His earpiece? Yes, you know those tiny speaker microphones that fancy security guards sometimes wear? What was he saying? Just reporting back whatever I was telling him. What'd you tell him? Nothing. That I didn't see anything. And he believed you? Why shouldn't he? Did you tell him about your friend? He takes another drag of his cigarette before knitting his brows. What friend? Your Sunday friend, the witness. No, I don't think it came up. Well, thanks for the information. Sure. Anything else on your mind? His lazy eyes stroll over your face. What are you doing here? Admiring the atmosphere, he smiles. What about you, officer? I'm here to kick some ass and solve the case I'm working on. Well, here's to you. He raises a glass before taking a sip of his drink, froth grazing his mouth. Bye-bye, gendarme. An unconfirmed sighting is just a story. These people here, I don't want to deal with them. Okay, Titus?
It's you again. What is it?
He acknowledges you gruffly. Me and Everett talked. He promised you'd cooperate. Ah, so you went and talked to my mommy? And now she's making me play with you? He spits. Is that it, lawman? Shanky says, and what's going to happen if we don't? The little guy leans forward. You're going to go and tell on us? Very mature, guys. Everett sent word, right? Yeah, I heard him. The hell do you think I'm doing here? You'd have your ass handed to you if it wasn't for the boss man's word. Let me state this very clearly, capo. He clears his throat and declares, Hello, officer. I'm Titus Hardie, and these are my boys, Hardie Boys. How may we assist you? Rhetoric says it would take an army to bend Titus to its will, but having Everett back you up like that did seem to have some effect. I found someone who saw the hanging. A witness. A witness? The tall man crosses his arms on his chest. They ain't got crap. The locals would never come to you with us. He's not a local. Alan says, that's just cop tactics, Titus. Next he's going to tell you one of us already rolled on the others and is in witness protection. My witness isn't a local. Titus scratches the back of his head and asks, well, let's hear it then. Who is you, mystery fella? Logic says, this goes without saying, but nonetheless, don't give out his name. He could just do it anyway. Let's just say he's a high-ranking government official and leave it at that. Yeah, right. Like we wouldn't know if an MI plant was in our town. Titus looks over his shoulder to his men. Nice try, right? Encyclopedia says MI is short for Moral Intern. Moral Intern is short for Moralist International, the coalition that runs Revachol. Alan says, I've seen this crap a million times, Titus. Fly fishing. They're desperate. He turns to you. Tell us, copper, what wacky claims did he make? The witness said the hanging went down very quietly. No shouting, no commotion. Shanky says, as you jerks that feel the need to go around like a brass band, the Hardie Boys are dead silent. Yeah, Alan says, it's like they put cowbells on you before they send you to the streets. He says provokingly, what's with the cowbells, policeman? Rhetoric says they're avoiding having to answer this question. I'd imagine you guys drinking and singing lynching songs. What's with the funeral silence? We were drinking, he looks around. Weren't we, guys? I hit the bottle hard. I was drunk as hell. The witness said he saw two people of Arapagite descent and one Mesk. Arapagite? Eugene starts laughing. Boss, I think he's trying to say me and Theo. Well, yeah, Titus nods. What is confusing you? Eugene, Theo, and Alan were there, too. I already told you, we were all there. About the witness. Some witness. I pulled the same crap. Came up with some crap, then went and said it to people. Get a reaction. Don't have to go to cop school to try that. Glenn says, you don't have to go to school for crap. I never went to school, and I'm doing great. Eugene says, you're doing a hell of a job, man. Hell of a job. Is Eugene talking to me or Glenn? Rhetoric says, so much bluster to hide the fact that they're uncomfortable with you having this info. I'll talk about the hanging again. Again, just get the dead guy's autograph, since you're his biggest fan. A burst of laughter in the room. The little guy is the loudest. Good one, Titus, he fawns. How does the bullet in his head factor into this? Huh? A sip of beer makes the surprise go down easier. How the hell do I know? Anyone could have shot him. Target practice, maybe? Another sip. He's tight-lipped suddenly. Drama says, interesting, sire. It's as if he's lying to protect someone. He's not very good at it. Elizabeth says, this line of questioning is over. The woman steps in before you can answer. You got the cause of death already. Hanging. If there's any post-mortem trauma, it's your problem. This will not turn into a cross-examination. No more questions? I can do this. Okay, so she might stop me if I try this. So let me try my rhetoric here. I have a high chance. Plus one for discussed Eighth Hardy and Everett asked to cooperate. Minus one for push Titus on a tape. Convince Titus he is being manipulated. Come on, let's go. Damn it. Failure. I don't know what went wrong the last time. You have so many good ideas here. Make them all see your puppets on a string, rhetoric says. Means this isn't gonna happen, and we can't quit out of it. Okay, man, it's clear you're being played like a fiddle. Play an imaginary fiddle. No, we aren't, jerk. Glenn jumps in, shouting. No one's fiddling anyone in here. No, Glenn, I want to hear this. Who do you think is fiddling me? I guess I'm talking to rhetoric here. Perform a dramatic finale on the imaginary fiddle. Just so I can hopefully end this. The hunter becomes the hunter. The hunter becomes the hunter? Titus shakes his head. A little tip for you, cop. Next time you try to screw with someone's head, make sure you're not screwed there yourself. Oof. Rhetoric says, I don't understand what happened. Why did you say that? I didn't tell you to say that. Put the fiddle down and never go off script like that again. Well, we can try it again if we do rhetoric. You still haven't explained the bullet I found in the hangman's head. You still on about that bullet? He pats the back of his head. A bullet in a hangman's head. You're right, copper. That is mighty curious. Truly curious. If you hanged him, how did it get there? He gives you an indulgent look. Well, there are so many bullets in the world and so many heads. I guess it's only logical. At some point, one of them bullets had to end up in one of them heads. Alan says, it's bound to happen again, you know. He taps on his right temple. Just statistically speaking, of course. Drama says, sire, it would be an event most dramatic if you were to produce the bullet and dangle it before their very eyes.
Really?
I hope they don't try to grab it or something. Alright, Drama, here we go. I'm going to ask you again, why was this in the victim's head? Wow. The little man leans in to inspect the leaden blossom. He's got it in a real evidence bag and all. Why don't you go home and log into evidence? Elizabeth says. These men have told you what happened. Did you guys shoot him? Crap. Glenn throws his head back. I probably did shoot him. I was drunk last night. You guys know me when I'm drunk. Okay, we're not getting anything out of these people. Shanky says, yeah, Glenn likes to shoot his guns when he's drunk. The little guy looks you in the eye. Better hope he stays sober. I meant before he was hanged. Before, after, during. She spreads her arms. This is getting ridiculous. They told you what happened. Stop wasting your time. I don't think I want to. I'm wasting my time, number one, and maybe I want to keep that for another time. Don't worry, I will figure this out sooner or later. Never been worried in my life, lawman. He crosses his hairy arms, having forgotten his beer for a moment. Logic says, we can try again. It's not like you blew it wide open, but there's a little crack in there somewhere. Okay, strange reaction to bullet, plus one, so we can try it again. Convince Titus he's being manipulated. Yay! Bad idea. Bringing her up will do no good. You should know by now. Titus will never falter. One of his boys will. Just remember, it's about more than Classier. It's about these men and Martinese. Their district, their responsibility. Well, that's it then. Case closed. I'm going home. Huh? Titus looks surprised. Rhetoric says, you caught the leader off guard. Now strike. Really? I'm going to start typing up my report. It's going to say, in Martinese, they just kill you because they don't like you. Shanky says, yeah, let them know. The little guy slams his fist on the table. We'll kill you dead. Because of some chick. Alan winces. It's involuntary. Bring that up one more time and you won't get to write that report. Am I on the right path here, or are these people just gonna kill me? I understand. You hang them, you shoot them, whatever. You can't even remember. Fat Angus says, it wasn't that. It wasn't. We didn't shoot him. The fat man says with a wheeze. Rhetoric says, that's it. That's the weak one. You flushed him out. No, go in for the... Theo says, officer, you will be next if you don't shut up. The old man reaches for his belt, but his voice is strangely calm. Rhetoric says, he's on to you. He knows what you're trying to do. Oh, God. I don't like either of these, even the way I'm provoking Theo. I could keep going on Angus. Or I could turn to Theo. Turning to Theo. What happens if I keep talking? You're gonna kill me too? In this bar? For nothing? No. You see him shake his silvery head. His calm voice is almost kind now. I'm not gonna do it. I'm too old for a shot like that now. You hear that, Angus? They're gonna kill me too. Oh. Reaction speed says, suddenly there's an awful ringing in your ears. Your body temperature spikes. You're burning all over with fear. Oh my God, what? You only managed to perform one more movement, an instinctive jerk to your left, then no sound, no one screams. It's impossible to say where it comes from. I'm dead. More dead cops. Peripheric. I think this is a different eulogy or whatever. Not eulogy. Notice of death? What are they? After all that, when did I save last? Obituary? It's not really an obituary. It's like an interview kind of, or a comment piece. Sad news from the district of Martinez, where the body of a police officer was found floating in a canal. It is believed the officer was pursuing a murder investigation but caught up in the dock worker strike and was subsequently gunned down under unclear circumstances. Such needless loss of life is truly tragic, local union leader Everard Clare commented, adding that although the event is truly horrid, similar incidents will follow if right-wing vigilantes are allowed to run around unchecked, attempting to wiggle their way into well-organized neighborhoods. Where am I here? Talking to him. I didn't save the last save. Okay, I'm gonna see if I can get back to where I was, only not dying. See you guys in a second. Okay, now trying this again. I don't consider it safe scumming because, well, I died. did everything the same as before? Pretty sure I followed all the same questions in the same order, and I talked to the man on the balcony over there first. And I saved after that, and now we're in here. Convinced Titus he's being manipulated. Try again. Failing again, same as the other time. So, trying to do the same thing. Imaginary fiddle. Hunter becomes the hunter. Damage my morale. You guys shoot him. And before he was hanged. Try to convince him.
It's you again. What is it?
Okay, I can save now. In case I die as a result of this. At least everything else was done the same.
It's you again. What is it?
Maybe the chick is a bad news. Bad idea. If I turn to Angus, or what? You're gonna kill me like you killed him for no reason? We didn't kill him! We didn't even hang him! He was dead when he takes a breath, wheezing. Shut up, Angus! He was dead before you hanged him? Fatty, Shanky says. The little guy hits Angus on the back of the head, a loud slap. Say one more thing to the cops and I'll... Dennis! Titus roars. Stand down or I'll beat your head in. Theo? He points to the old man. Take your hand off the belt. This isn't 31. I've got this under control. Do we die now? The room falls quiet. So quiet you can hear Angus wheeze. Angie, where's your goddamn inhaler? You sound like you're dying. I left it home. I can't get it. I'm too screwed. He grabs his chest. I'm sorry. Why are you so fat, Angus? As he snaps at him. Now it's all pointless because of you. You wasted my time. I told you, Titus. She turns to him. I told you, just give her up. Lizzie, he turns to the fixer. Your help is no longer needed here. Go tell Everard. Fine, I'll tell him. After a long walk along the coast. She walks off without looking back. Are we gonna live? Redrick says you're in. He's all yours. Questions? So you... Well, that's not a question. Actually, these are questions. So you didn't kill him. He was already dead. Titus nods. You hanged a corpse to cover up the real cause of death. The bullet in his head. Another nod. Why? Because the girls asked us to. They're in some crap. Redrick says, girls, plural? There's another girl? Two of them? Take note of this. They'll probably say more about her later. Did she kill him? Cop, I have no idea. The girl says she didn't. Empathy says he doesn't think she did, or at least he hopes she didn't. Right, so that's the crucial moment. If you talk to the old guy, I forget his name. Theo? Yeah, if you talk to Theo at that point, there's probably multiple ways around this. But at least the circuitous route that I took. If you talk to Theo, if you yell at him, you end up getting shot. If you keep going at Eugene, you don't, because I don't know why. Because Eugene admitted it. They could have shot me then, to stop me from walking away and knowing what Eugene said. Empathy says he doesn't think she did kill him, or at least he hopes she didn't. What happened Sunday night? Classier came down. He points to the stairs. She seemed really out of it. Drugged up, even more than usual. Bug-eyed and gurning, you know. Not in a fun way. I don't know what gurning means. It looked like she'd redosed after something went down. I've seen that look before. She was scared. I knew someone died. How'd you know? I've done this job for 10 years. Seen it before. It's the politician in the motel room with the dead hooker scenario. Only in reverse. Good analogy, boss. Shanky, the rat-faced man snickers. You don't get to talk yet, Shanky. He points at him. You're still on the bench, and you keep taking it easy too, Angus. He turns back to you. What happened then? We went upstairs. Sure as day, the Merc was dead, and there was a bullet hole through the window. He scratches his chin. Dirty sheets and bottles everywhere. Redrick says he means they'd been having sex. Tibbs patched the window, and the corpse, we hanged. Who's Tibbs? The 8th Hardie? Nah, he's my brother. He's in the window replacement business. Tibbs. That's short for conceptualization. Says, short for Tiberius? Yeah, he nods. Good man. Conceptualization says, bet their father's named Atticus Hardie. Lucretia Hardie would be their sister. Anyway. If Classier didn't kill him, why the cover-up? You may have noticed our girl's in some crap of her own. I didn't notice anything. What kind of crap are we talking about? The can't-show-up-on-police-radar kind. There are people after her from the old, old world where she came from. These people, who are they? They're powerful. He looks out the window. Connected to the moral intern. She's clearly afraid for her life. Says if she showed up in your system, she'd be ghosted away. Huh. I wonder if that bureaucrat's looking for her. He's from the moral intern. Jama says that's all he knows. That's all she's told him. Why would you help someone like that out? Why would I? He looks at you in the eye. I guess we abide all sorts of runaways and losers here. It's a Martinez thing. Whose idea was it to hang him, anyway? Hers? In a manner of speaking. Reaction Speed says, remember the two girls? He may be talking about the other one. Earlier you said the girls asked for your help. Was this the other girl? That's right, he blinks. It was her idea to hang him. I liked it, for political reasons. It sent a good message. It's her, isn't it? The missing 8th Hardie. That's the other girl. The big guy turns to Glenn, who's about to say something. The blonde shuts his mouth before a word escapes. Okay, Glenn knows something. I'll say it again. Titus turns to you. All the Hardie Boys are right here, cop. That woman is just affiliated with the Hardie Boys. You don't know her anyway. Understood. Can you tell me anything about her? Name, current location? Nope, he says. You're not getting to her. It's Classier you want to talk to. So who killed the Merc then? Any leads? Not yet. Just some ideas. She says the shot came from outside, behind the window somewhere. So that's a clue. What are you thinking? I'm thinking someone's past caught up with them. Either hers or his. Hers? I mean the people after Classier. Maybe the shot missed. Maybe it was meant for her? I like that. Eugene nods. Been thinking the same thing myself. And you had ideas about his past, too? I do. One of those mercenary buddies of his could have done it. They got guns, training, years of bad blood, probably. Or it could have been someone else from a Krennel. He pauses to think. Tell you what I'd do. Check out the coast for vantage points. Maybe consult with a ballistics buddy of mine. That's what I'd do, if I wasn't too busy doing this clown dance with you. I'm sorry I made you guys fight. Me too. Thank you for this, Titus. I'll go talk to her. For the last time. You do that. He grabs his beer and swirls it in his hand. then thinks of something. Hey, cop, before you go. She... He looks up. Classier came to Martinez to hide. Many of us did. This is where you wash up when there's nowhere left to go. The union takes you in. Now, she refused that protection, but... But you would still prefer it if we didn't take her away? That's right. If we didn't take care of the people who end up here, this place would just be a couple of ruins and some cargo containers. Wow. Wowie wowie, okay. I'm practically a shrink minus the diploma. Beer makes me a better driver. Okay, next episode I guess we'll talk to some of these people again. Meaning these people here, see if they have anything new to say, including the cook. Try to get through there again. That door we were trying to get through. Barred door. That's the door by Classier. We were trying to get in there. So we can try that again when we go talk to Classier. So, there's that stuff. Anyway, this is our longer than usual huge 50th episode. No, I don't need to see the chokehold again. And he says, can do it with class, don't do it at all. What, the chokehold, I mean? He means, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and always seek adventure.